Controlled Environment Plant Production Engineering Technology Education modules are developed and presented by The Ohio State University, Rutgers, the State University of New Jersey, and the University of Arizona, with support from USDA NEFA through their Higher Education Challenge Grant Program. In this module, we'll discuss the topic of greenhouse safety. This module is presented by Dr. Peter Ling of The Ohio State University, Dr. A.J. Both of Rutgers, the State University of New Jersey, and Luke Power of The Ohio State University. This greenhouse safety module will allow you to meet 6 objectives. By the end of this module, you will be able to describe the consequences of poor greenhouse safety, prevent chemical injury, prevent electrical shock, prevent worker injuries from repetitive motions in hazardous environments, prevent injury due to moving equipment, and conduct a greenhouse safety check. The first objective is to describe the consequences of poor greenhouse safety. A history of worker or customer accidents can raise insurance costs, result in OSHA penalties, cause bad employee relationships, or result in lawsuits. Here we see a picture of customers walking on a wet floor next to an untidy water hose. This scenario could lead to a fall or trip. All of the items mentioned on this slide have one thing in common, and that is that it will cost the grower money. Safety concerns can be divided into 4 categories, which we will cover in this module: chemical, electrical, equipment, and environmental safety concerns inherent to human beings in the greenhouse. Work in the greenhouse requires repetitive motions and awkward positions that can lead to injury. A wet environment due to high humidity or irrigation can lead to slips, trips, or falls. Falling objects improperly stored overhead can also be a safety concern. The greenhouse environment not only poses a threat to employees, but also customers in a retail operation. Objective 2 is to prevent chemical injury. Greenhouses contain toxic and corrosive chemicals, such as pesticides and herbicides, fertilizers, cleaners, and acids. Pesticides and herbicides are used to control plant diseases, pests, and weeds. They are typically a health hazard. Fertilizers are used to enhance plant growth. They are typically unstable, corrosive, and a health hazard. Cleaners are used for disinfecting as part of an integrated pest management. For more information on integrated pest management, please view the pest management modules. Cleaners are typically flammable and a health hazard. Acids can be used to correct pH of nutrient solutions. They are typically unstable and a health hazard. With all of these dangerous chemicals in the greenhouse, chemical safety is a very worthy topic. This diamond-shaped symbol can be seen on many different chemicals. This symbol defines the health hazard, flammability, instability, and any specific hazards for a chemical compound. Here is an example code for ammonium nitrate, a common fertilizer. As indicated by the blue square, this chemical is slightly hazardous to health. As indicated by the red square, this chemical will not burn. As indicated by the yellow square, this chemical is highly unstable. And as indicated by the white square, this chemical is an oxidizer. All agricultural chemicals will have a label. The chemical label for this fungicide pictured here peels and folds out for full information. The chemical label is the law. Read it. Chemical labels list chemical formulation, precautionary statements, personal protective equipment or PPE requirements, application method, projected length of exposure, and signal word. The signal word helps identify the toxicity of the chemical. Danger indicates a highly toxic chemical by at least one route of exposure. It may be absorbed through the skin, ingested, or inhaled. This chemical may also cause irreversible damage to skin and eyes. Warning indicates a moderately toxic chemical if absorbed through the skin, ingested, or inhaled. It may also cause moderate skin or eye irritation. Caution indicates a slightly toxic chemical if absorbed through the skin, ingested, or inhaled. It may also cause minor skin or eye irritation. Upon reading the chemical label, one can safely mix, apply, store, and dispose of the chemical. With respect to chemicals, it is also important to keep Material Safety Data Sheets, or MSDS, on hand for all chemicals. Store chemicals in original and labeled containers inside locking and labeled cabinets. Use proper chemical storage cabinets. And do not allow cabinets to freeze or get too hot. Get certification of storage facilities by the local fire department. Enforce the use of personal protective equipment when using chemicals. Keep chemicals and spray equipment out of customer reach. Ensure that chemical runoff does not surpass federal limits. This will help to avoid personal injury and fines. Objective 3 is to prevent electric shock. First, let's discuss some electrical background. Voltage is the force that causes electricity to flow. Current is the amount of electricity flowing. I will make a comparison here with a river. Voltage is analogous to the grade of the land. The more sloped the land, the more force is driving the water to flow. Current is analogous to the amount of water present in the river. Resistance slows down or stops the current by converting electrical energy into heat energy. The more resistance an object has, the less current can pass through it. Insulators, such as rubber, have a very high resistance. Conductors, such as metal, have a very low resistance. The hot wire is the supply path for electrical current. The neutral wire is the normal return path for electrical current. The ground wire is the connection between a circuit and the ground. This is usually made by a rod driven into the earth. In a wet greenhouse environment, the risk of electric shock is high. Water in the greenhouse environment contains dissolved salts. Condensate dissolves salts from surfaces, and irrigation contains dissolved salts from the water source. Dissolved salts are capable of carrying an electric current through water. When water connects a person with two different conductors of different voltages, or connects a person to a ground and an electric source simultaneously, that person will receive an electric shock. To make matters worse, wet skin has lower electrical resistance to current than dry skin. A current that normally would not shock a person with dry skin is capable of shocking a person whose skin is wet. Or, a shock that is normally non-lethal may become lethal when skin is wet, as the skin becomes capable of carrying more current. As little as 0.1 amps of electric current can be lethal. For comparison, a standard outlet carries 15 amps. How can we prevent electrical shock? One way is covering breakers and outlets. This will shield them from dripping condensate and misdirected water sprays. Here we see condensate dripping from an electrical plug. The image to the right shows a non-conductive piece of plastic used to shield the outlet from water. Another way of preventing electrical shock is by using ground fault circuit interrupters, or GFCIs, in areas where outlets can get wet. As we discussed previously, water can conduct current away from an outlet in an unwanted and dangerous direction. GFCIs compare the current in the hot or live wire to the current in the neutral or return wire. Less current in the neutral wire means somebody could be getting shocked by the missing current. This unequal current quickly shuts off electricity. The reset button must be pressed in order to restore power. If reset does not work, the short may still exist. The test button can be used to ensure proper operation of the GFCI. On the image to the right, the reset button is red and the test button is black. How do you help a shock victim? Immediately call for help and dial 911. The victim may not be able to pull away from an electrical power source, so cut the power. But do not touch the victim while he or she is being shocked. Touching the victim during shock can shock the person in contact. Here are some additional electrical safety tips. Watch for damaged wires or cords. Do not overload circuits. For example, do not use a power strip to run too many devices. Lock out or tag out switches when working on equipment. This means that the power switch should be locked so that it cannot be turned on. If it is not possible to lock out the power switch, then a warning tag should be placed on the switch. In case of electrical fire, shut off all power and use an extinguisher approved for electrical fires. Using water to put out an electrical fire can result in a fatal shock. Use equipment with 3-pronged plugs. In the event that equipment is either damaged or inundated with water, equipment can become charged with electricity. The third prong is designed to carry electricity away from the equipment in this case so that the user does not become the path of electricity. Do not use tools that give you a tingling sensation, as this indicates stray current. Hire a licensed electrician for all electrical work. Objective 4 is to prevent worker injuries from repetitive motions in hazardous environments. Common injuries in the greenhouse are joint and muscle injuries from awkward repetitive motions, such as bending over or use of arms and hands. Some examples include back injuries from improper lifting and/or stooped posture. Cuts to fingers or hands occur from fatigue while using cutting tools. Wrist injuries from long-duration repetitive motion. Falls due to wet surfaces or obstacles, and injury due to hanging or falling objects that have been improperly mounted or stored overhead are also common sources of injury in the greenhouse. Let's take a closer look at hand and wrist injuries. Cuts from the use of cutting tools typically happen close to the end of the workday when workers become complacent, tired, and lose concentration. Workers should maintain a high level of awareness when using cutting tools. Cuts and abrasions can occur to the hands when lifting heavy objects, such as pots that may have sharp edges. Specialized working gloves can prevent cuts and abrasions. There are many activities in the greenhouse that require repetitive motion of the hands and wrists. A common example is propagation activities. Repetitive motion injuries occur when the wrist is bent for an extended period of time. Adjust body position relative to the work surface so the wrist is straight. Encourage short resting and stretching of hands every half hour. For example, stretching can be accomplished by first separating and extending the fingers for 10 seconds. Next, relax and bend the fingers at the knuckles for 10 seconds. Again, separate and extend fingers for 10 seconds. Finally, stretch each wrist backwards using the other hand for 10 seconds. Now let's take a closer look at back injuries. Stooping, bending forward and down from the waist and/or mid-back while maintaining relatively straight legs, and squatting, bending of the knees so that the buttocks rests on or near the heels, can cause cumulative damage. Costs of first-time back injuries are estimated at $10,000, while repeat injuries can cost as much as $300,000. Once a first injury occurs, a second injury is more likely. Damage to the back can be reduced by considering appropriate working height, improved body position, rotation, footing, and reducing fatigue. Appropriate working height will reduce the need to stoop and squat. Raised planting beds and work areas can reduce squatting and stooping and therefore reduce the risk of back injury. For good body position, consider devices that facilitate kneeling rather than squatting or stooping. When lifting objects from ground level, lift by bending at the knees and lifting with the legs. Feet should be shoulder width apart and as close as possible to the object to be lifted. Bend down at the knees and keep the back straight. The worker will feel like he or she is squatting very close to the object. Get a good grip on the object. Then, lift gradually, using the muscles of the legs and keeping the back straight and the item close to the body on the way up. When placing heavy objects on the ground, use the reverse process, emphasizing that the object should be placed very close to the feet. A lifting belt may be worn to improve lifting posture. While being carried, heavy objects should be held as close as possible to the body. Consider tool extensions or mechanical harvesting that allows workers to work in standing or laying positions. Rotation refers to how an object is repositioned from in front of a worker to behind the worker. For example, a worker may be standing between two benches, moving pots from one bench to the other. Reposition objects by moving feet, not rotating at the torso. Poor footing reduces the weight of objects that can be safely carried. It also makes carrying objects with sharp edges dangerous. Avoid messy, uneven, rocky, or muddy terrain. Lastly, reduce fatigue by enforcing breaks, reducing working hours, and hiring more labor during peak periods. Fatigue makes any working condition more dangerous. Here are some other good safety measures to keep in mind with regard to safety from repetitive motions and hazardous environments. Do not run in the greenhouse at any time. Enforce appropriate dress code. This usually includes closed-toe and non-slip shoes, as well as wearing goggles when using equipment that generates projectiles. Damage to hearing is cumulative. Hearing protection should always be worn around loud equipment. Keep work areas clean. Rotate repetitive tasks to limit fatigue and injury. Require employees to seek help when lifting heavy objects. Conduct a hazard inspection daily. And enforce the safety rules with an appropriate reward and penalty system. Objective 5 is to prevent injury due to moving equipment. Some equipment that might cause personal injury in the greenhouse includes tractors, trailers, forklifts, loaders, potting machines, soil mixers, conveyor belts, other electrical equipment, heating systems, and autonomous devices. This list provides several examples, but it is not exhaustive. How do we prevent injury from greenhouse equipment? For safety, there are precautions to be observed both prior to and during operation. Prior to equipment operation, ensure that the operator is trained specifically for the machine or tool being used. Prior to operation of equipment, perform a safety inspection. During this inspection, check belts and chains to ensure that they are properly operating. Ensure all safety equipment is functioning correctly. Examples include seat belts, lights, roll protection, fire extinguishers, guards, and brakes. Repair fuel, oil, or hydraulic fluid leaks. Never operate equipment that is not in safe operating condition. Employees should notify a supervisor immediately of damaged or non-functioning equipment. Power off equipment when making adjustments or repairs. The power should be locked out or tagged out. Clean dirty parts. It is difficult to determine the working condition of parts when they are dirty. Also, a clean machine will suffer less wear. Secure or eliminate loose-fitting clothing or hanging hair prior to operating machinery with moving parts. Baggy clothing can become stuck in moving parts and drag a person into the machine. Fingers and other body parts should be kept clear of moving parts or pinch points. Be sure all machine guards are in place. And ensure that people and tools are clear before starting up the equipment. During equipment operation, always use seat belts or other safety equipment if they are provided. Always operate equipment at safe speeds. Higher speeds can increase the risk and severity of injury. Slower speeds give workers more time to react in an emergency situation. Avoid distractions such as phones or earphones when operating equipment. Be aware of surroundings. And lastly, use proper personal protective gear such as gloves, glasses, face shields, and hearing protection. Objective 6 is to conduct a greenhouse safety check. It is a good idea to develop and use safety checklists for this task. Here are some examples of checklists to create and use. A new employee orientation checklist. A first aid equipment checklist. A routine safety inspection checklist. And a severe weather checklist. This may include closing greenhouse vents or moving employees and customers to a shelter area. Keep records of all completed checklists. Here is an example checklist available on the internet. This and others can be found at the website listed at the bottom of the screen. Let's look more closely at the fire safety and security section. The inspector will mark yes or no for each item. Are fire extinguishers clearly marked? Have fire extinguishers been inspected within the last year? Are workers trained to use fire extinguishers? Are flammable liquids stored properly? Are emergency phone numbers posted where they can be found? We recommend you visit the website listed as reference number 2 for videos on greenhouse safety with repetitive motions, heavy lifting, chemicals, eye and hearing safety, and equipment safety. Thank you for viewing.